stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Constant grace remains the core. caused your sun to shine on darkest nights. For all that you've done, we will pour out our love. This will be our anthem song. Jesus, we love.
Us more aware of your presence. Thank you that you are always there. We open up our hearts to you. We let go of the things that hinder love. And we welcome you deeper. We're so grateful for you, God. Sing this together. All my words fall short.
All my words fall short. I've got nothing new. as I often do, but every song must end, but you never do.
So I'll throw up my hands.
I'll throw up my hands. I'll praise you again and again, 'cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. I know it's not much, I'm nothing else fit for a king, except for
celebration, at our breaking point, at our highest point. Your nature doesn't change. You are good. You are for us. So we separate circumstances this morning from your nature. We lean into trusting you, God. So may we sing this with a new heart and a new passion. Come on, my soul. Don't you get shy. Lift up your soul.
So come on, my soul. Don't you get shy on me, lift up your song. You've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord.
You're worthy, God.
Come on, my soul. Don't you get shy on me, lift up your song. You've got a lion inside. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Yes, Lord, we do sing hallelujah. Praise you. Yeah. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless him. Father, we gather in worship of you because you are holy and worthy of all worship and glory and honor and praise forever. We give you ourselves this morning. Amen. Amen. Well, you may be seated. Hello, everyone, and welcome. We are glad that you're here with us. My name is Luke, if I haven't gotten to meet you yet. I'm the pastor of student ministries here at the River Church, which means I get to hang out with your junior high and high school students, and they are just some wonderful people, and I absolutely love it. And we're going to camp in a couple weeks, and we're really looking forward to that as well. I'm sure those of you who have are parents of junior high and high school students are looking forward to sending them away for a week as well to get a little bit of a break. Hey, we want to take a moment as a church body just to recognize the events that just happened yesterday. The attack on our attempted assassination on our former President Donald Trump. This is just another example of sin in the world, of how deeply divided our nation is right now politically, about just really where we are. It's sad. For me, it's sad to stand and watch and witness just the deep divide happening in our country, and that which happens also inside of our own hearts. I believe that sin and just everything runs deep and is deep inside of us. And this is another example of where sin is in the world. And also for me as a pastor serves as this really important time for us as the Jesus people and the Jesus community to stand as a witness in the midst of all this. We are invited into something much greater and much better with Jesus as King. So for us as a community, I think this is a really important moment, especially as we look forward into this political season where I think the divide is going to continue to surface itself all the more, that we are together united with King Jesus as our central point and focus. And so in order to help us and lead us into this morning, I want to remind us of a couple things. One is that the Bible commands us to pray for our leaders, to pray for our political leaders. I think that's important for us to be doing right now. You know, you might find yourself on one side or the other of the political spectrum, but we need to be praying for the leaders that are going to be running our country. The other thing I like to remind us of is that Jesus commands us to love our enemies. Right now, it feels like the hate is so deep for the other side. And the way of Jesus is the exact opposite of what we're seeing. The love that we are intended to exemplify for our country and for the people that we disagree with, right? Like, this is who Jesus is. We are commanded to love our enemies. And so what I'd like to do this morning is to put these two together. And we often see these two conflated, right? Of our political enemies are the ones that we hate. But I would like to lead us in prayer right now. So I'm going to have a moment of silence. What I want you to do is to pray for the political leader of the party that you do not align yourself with as an act of inward, the inward journey into our own heart and reflection of those anger and the feelings that we have towards the opposite party, to pray and to pray for them and pray through those thoughts together. And then after a few moments, I'm going to pray for us and for our nation together. So we're going to have a moment now where I invite you to pray for our political leaders. All right. Father, we come before you with many emotions and heavy hearts and saddened by what took place yesterday. And Father, we are reminded that you are on the throne now and forever, that you are King over our lives, that you are King over the whole world and the USA as a part of that. So you will rule and reign And we pray for us as a community that we be a community of peace, of your peace and shalom, of right relationships with each other, and that we would extend your peace into the world, that we be people of love. And so we offer this part of our hearts, of our minds, of our lives to you, fully giving it over, trusting that you will change us and mold us and shape us to be good citizens here as we follow you in your way. So, Father, we give you ourselves. Change us. And we pray for this election cycle. We pray for President Biden and former President Trump. Father, would you give them all wisdom and understanding and the people around them to help lead this nation well and to create unity in a deeply divided people. Father, you must be at work to bring the peace that you have promised. So, Father, in all this, is for the sake and glory of King Jesus that we pray these things. Amen. Well, thank you for taking the moment to pray with me through that. There is a lot of really amazing things going on at the river that you do not always get to see and notice. I mean, the Lord is healing people in our midst, and the Lord is bringing new people to faith, and the Lord is growing so many of us deeper into deeper, more personal, intimate relationships with Jesus, where he is taking the deep parts of us and changing it and molding it, and it's beautiful and fun to be a part of. Just yesterday, we were able to host a team from a ministry team, Passion SoCal from East LA, and we had a beach day, and we taught them how to surf, and man, was that really fun. I mean, it was like, some of these people, it's like they've only been in the ocean a handful of times, right? And some of them will say they're new to swimming, like their swimming skill set wasn't great, but we were standing there in kind of like waist-high water, pushing them into the waves, and I was a bit nervous about it, but man, you see them try to get up, and then they fall, and just the excitement on their face after they've just purled was so fun to see. Like, they were just having the best time, and it was really good for us just as a community to get to partner with them, and we were just, man, just so excited about what God is doing through them. So it was a really special moment for us as a community to partner with them and care for them, provide some community. So there's going to be more events with Passion LA that we are excited to introduce you guys into and for you to get to know them as well. If you are a regular member of the river, regular attender, we just invite you to give. And I'm standing here as a pastor saying this not for us, but because this is a discipleship. I mean, I know in my own life and heart, and I've seen among my friends, this is one of the places of our lives that's really hard to give over to the Lord. And just the practice and pattern of regular giving is just a part of our discipleship journey into deeper growth. And so as Francois, about 2 months ago, came up here and shared, we are a church family, and part of our giving stocks that pantry together. We see this as a big kind of family gathering, and we get to stock our pantry, and then all of us together get to use what's in the pantry to go and do the things that the Lord has called us to do here in the South Bay. All of us in this ministry get to use that pantry together to go out and do the ministry that the Lord has called us. So that's what we're inviting you to participate in this discipleship journey. So we are also really excited is that we have a team that is going to Africa very soon. So I'd like to invite Barb and Joe up again. I know. Yeah, clap for them. We at the river are just so excited about what God is doing in our midst, but also around the world. And we want to capture the heart of our Lord. Our Lord has the heart of being a missional God. He cares for the entire world, and God is doing some really amazing things. And we're excited for your team to go and experience that and share with us too about what God is doing over there. And we just want to send you out with a blessing. So I want to pray for you in a moment. But first, can you both just give us a little insight or update into what this trip is all about?
Thank you very much, Luke. Good morning, River Church. We're very excited to be returning to Uganda. Big word, huh? And we'll be spending some time with our brothers and sisters. Actually, it's our family there. The Moors will be joining us and becoming part of that bigger family. We'll be spending some time with the schools and the life homes where we've been doing a lot of construction work. A six classroom block, probably almost done in Kakogi by the time we get there. And we intend to spend a lot of time with the communities we serve, and in particular with some of the kids in the life homes.
So yeah, our hope for this trip is that Joe and I have been several times since we are part of a line. Corey and Susie Moore, this will be their first time coming, and then we have someone coming from Saddleback Church, Jerry Dallow, and we're just hoping that they will see how God is working in Uganda. It is so exciting to go over there and just watch people, watch the changes. Every year we come back and we see new faces and we see new developments, and for us, it's such a blessing just to be a part of all this. This trip this year is going to be probably a little more difficult. In our life home village, we have four homes for 40 children who have been abandoned, abused, or orphaned. And they basically have no family to speak of, and or the family has turned over the rights to the state. So we have 40 children there. Sadly, we had a little girl who was 11, and she'd been fighting leukemia, probably HIV positive. Many of the children are still there. AIDS is still, sadly, it plays a role in Africa. Anyway, so Shadia had been fighting leukemia, and she passed away this past Wednesday. So we anticipate, there's a lot of younger children in the life home right now, and we anticipate that that's going to be really something that they will still be coming to terms with while we're there. So we're hoping and praying that the activities we have planned and our time together will help move them along in their path of grief. So anyways, thank you.
Yeah, thank you for the update. Let me pray for you. Both, if you're comfortable, would you extend a hand in praying for them? Father, go before Barb and Joe and Susie and Corey. Would you be at work in the lives of these kids and just comfort them? Comfort them in this loss and provide this team with the right words, the right presence, the right things to say and do to be there to best help and aid and assist the team that's there and what you're already doing. And Father, you have gifted them and raised them to be people after your own heart. Barb and Joe love you, and they have caught your heart of service, and thank you for that gift for our congregation. So Father, would you just bless them, bless this trip? Would it be a time of joy and fruitfulness and a time for us as a community to just come around and support them? So Father, go before them and beyond them. Amen. Thank you both. Thank you so much for what you do. All right, so we are going to take a moment now, as is our regular rhythm, to say hi to someone. I invite you to say hi to someone that's new or that you don't know well, and then I'll call us back in a few minutes, and we'll hear from Brooke teaching. All right, see you in a sec. So far, and I'm excited to hear us, for us to hear from Brooke. One, because Brooke is a gifted teacher. She is, I mean, the Lord has anointed you for this and what you're doing. And as I was saying and thinking about it, it's Brooke, your life preaches, I think, louder even than your messages. And it's really powerful for us. And I'm just glad to sit under you and hear your teaching and leading us. So let me pray for you and excited to hear what the Lord says. Father, would you, just speak. Speak now, for your servants are here listening. We believe that your Holy Spirit has been present with Brooke as she has been preparing this message, and that you have been speaking to her the word for us today. And so would you help us now, Holy Spirit, to listen well for what you are saying to our community, and help us live into the grace and reality of the grand story that you are designing. So speak through Brooke this morning, and this we pray in your son's name. Amen.
All right, guys, it's good to be back with all of you. Whoop. That would have been a rough start. I want you to kind of just take a deep breath and settle in, because today is kind of a weird one. I would say we're about to walk into a little more of a lecture and less of a sermon. So I just want to preface with, you know, kind of put your scholarly thinking caps on. We're going to really dig into and read through a lot of scripture. And if you're thinking like, oh man, I can't handle this, I'm going to check out, don't do it, because this is such important foundation that is going to help you understand all of scripture and what's coming next and the rest of the series. But when you have context for what's going on, it's just so, so important, so good. So that said, We're going to read a lot of the Bible, and I want to talk about how we read the Bible. And there are a few different approaches that many of us take to reading the Bible. I read this from one of my favorite Bible teachers years ago, and it kind of stuck with me. And she said, sometimes we approach reading the Bible like a drive-thru. I've got 5 minutes, give me something fresh and hot and fast, and then I'm on my way, right? Some of us approach the Bible like a pinball machine. I'm not really sure where to start, what to read today, so I'm going to read here. And that's your quiet time for the day. You just kind of open to a flip to a page is kind of the pinball, random, right? Some of us read the Bible like with a personal shopper. And the personal shopper approach to reading the Bible is like we don't really have the time and thought and energy to like really dig through what the text means. So we're just going to turn to our favorite preacher, our favorite Bible teacher, and they're going to do the work for us. And they're going to tell us what we need to know about the Bible or the text that we're trying to understand. Some of us, we read the Bible like a magic eight ball. And that's like, oh, Lord, there's this decision, this thing in my life that I need wisdom for, that I need insight. Whatever I read today, I'm just going to believe that that's you speaking to me. So we open our, you know, our passage to any random thing or to the specific passage that we're in the middle of reading, and we say, oh, Lord, make haste to help. Oh, I guess that's the Lord answering, you know, this decision that I'm trying to make in my life. So some of us read it like that. Some of us read it like the telephone game. The telephone game approach to reading scripture is I'm going to read a commentary about scripture or a book about the Bible instead of reading the Bible itself. It's kind of like the personal shopper, right? So there's all these different ways that we approach reading scripture. The picky eater, any picky eaters out there? Picky eater says, there's this one thing in the Bible, this topic, this passage, this section that it doesn't really align with my worldview. Or I don't understand it. Or it feels controversial. So I'm just going to skip over that part. And I'm not going to read that part in my quiet time. Or I'm just going to ignore it. I'm not going to dig into it. I'm not going to ask the Lord what it means. I'm just going to picky eat. I'm going to choose around. And so we have all of these kind of little habits that we fall into when we're reading scripture. I am guilty of every single one of these at times. And I'm sure you're going, okay, I've done that before. I've done that. And if you're wondering, like, hey, I do that all the time. What's wrong with that? It is better, I will tell you, that you're reading the Word of God and that you're pursuing it than not at all. So good for you for pressing in. And even if you're going to another teacher to help you understand it or listening to a podcast or a sermon or whatever it might be, that's better than not reading the Word of God at all. But there is this holistic, ideal approach to reading scripture that just makes everything make more sense. It's the way that God intended for us to read the Word of God. And it's with this bigger picture story in mind. It's a view of who is God and what is he doing throughout these pages and how are they connected? What is the movement of the big story or the meta-narrative of scripture? And hopefully this sounds familiar because we've been talking about this week after week, and that's the series that we're in, is understanding the big picture and all of these little sections and how they fit together. And so this may feel like a recap for you, but just so you know where we are, we started with creation. God creating man in his image to love and worship and be with him, and Adam and Eve sinned and separated humanity from God, right? And there's this sin that in the world, the separation that carries through humanity and keeps us from God. And then humans, we are trying to get back to the presence of God, and God sends these laws and this promise through Abraham. And hopefully you've been paying attention as we've been, you know, working through this story. And Bill talked about the promise through Abraham and the covenant that God offered to his people to bless his people and to bless Abraham's descendants and to be with them and to provide land and to bless them for all time to come. And this covenant is important because it carries on through eternity. Does this sound familiar to you? This big picture story. And so I wanted to paint this picture and just remind you of where we are. We've got this promise, this covenant from Abraham. Last week, James gave, I think, one of James's best sermons of all times. I really mean that. The blueberry muffin, were you guys here? So good, right? What did he say about the blueberry muffin? The law section in the Old Testament is like the little blueberries that are in the muffin. You can't who would take out the blueberries from the muffin and eat them separately, right? That'd be weird. And some of you do that. That's weird. Maybe my kids do that. But they're meant to be taken in context. What was the point of the laws? Why did God give the laws? He gave the laws to his people to set them apart, to make them holy, to make them different from all the other nations, to reunite the people with himself as they became pure and holy and sacrificed and set apart for God. But they could never fulfill all of the laws, right? How many of them are there? Did James cover that? I don't know. So good. So where we are is we've got Adam to Abraham, 10 generations. We got Abraham, the father of Isaac. Isaac's son, let me say this a better way, is Jacob. Jacob's son is Joseph. Are you following with me? Who's Joseph? The Technicolor coat guy, right? That leads everybody to Egypt where they end up in slavery. And then they're in Egypt, and then they're in slavery. And who leads them out of slavery? Moses. And then who leads them into the promised land? Joshua. Are some of these stories, you're going, oh yeah, I know that story. I know that story. It's just hard to fit them all together in our brain. What's the order? And what's the big picture story? And that's why we're reminding, this is not just like, you know, fluff in the beginning of the sermon. This is important context that we really understand, where are we? And so they're in the promised land. And there's these tribes of Israel and these judges, and there's this really famous judge named Samuel. And that's where we're going to pick up the story. With Samuel, chapter 8, if you want to read with me. And we're going to read like 6 chapters of scripture. So if you're like, I just want to listen, I want to hear this like a story, it is a story. So you're welcome to just sit back and listen. If you want to follow along on your phone or in your Bible, you're welcome to do that. So we pick up with a judge, Samuel, in 1 Samuel chapter 8, verse 1. When Samuel grew old, he appointed his son as Israel's leaders. The name of his firstborn was Joel, the name of his second was Abijah, and they served at Beersheba. But his sons did not follow his ways. They turned aside after dishonest gain and accepted bribes and perverted justice. So all the elders of Israel gathered together and came to Samuel at Ramah, and they said to him, "You are old and your sons don't follow your ways. Now appoint a king, bum, 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 to lead us, such as all the other nations have." Ugh. But when they said, "Give us a king to lead us," it displeased Samuel. So he prayed to the Lord, and the Lord told him, "Listen to all the people are saying to you. It is not you they have rejected, but they have rejected me as their king." Crushing. "As they have done from the day I brought them up out of Egypt until this day, forsaking me, serving other gods, so they are doing to you." That's my kid in the background. Sorry. "Now listen to them, but warn them solemnly and let them know what the king who will reign over them will claim as his rights." So Samuel told, verse 10, all the words the Lord told to the people who were asking him for a king. He said, "This is what the king who will reign over you is going to do. He's going to take your sons." I'm going to skip through this section because it's a lot. "He's going to take your daughters. He's going to take the best of your fields and vineyards, a tenth of your grain, your male and female servants, the best of your cattle. He will take a tenth of your flock, and you yourselves will become his slaves. And when that day comes, you will cry out for relief from the king that you chose, but the Lord will not answer you in that day." But the people refused to listen to Samuel. "No," they said, "we want a king over us." They sound like children, don't they? "No," I picture it like that. "We want a king. Then we will be like all the other nations, with a king to lead us and go out before us and fight our battles." And when Samuel heard all the people said, he repeated it before the Lord, and the Lord answered, "Listen to them and give them a king." This is so sad. This is like, this chapter has always stuck out to me in the Bible, because you know those like, those little moments that change everything? Like, it's like that tiny thing that seems like, oh, it's just one little thing that happens in scripture, it's not that big of a deal, but really, the what's it called? Like when everything crumbles? the effect of this moment of God saying, okay, you guys have forsaken me since I led you out of Egypt. This is what you want. Just so you know, these are the consequences. Are you sure you want it? And they're like, yes, we do. And God's like, okay, you can have a king. And you just know that this is going to end badly. Like, you know where this is going to go. There's no way that this could go somewhere good. And it doesn't. And it's so sad. And so this begins the period of the kings. The first king that's chosen is chosen by God is Saul. And we know Saul is chosen by God, but then he gets crazy, right? And then the next king that comes after him is David. And David is the man after God's own heart, but then he has an affair, and then he kills the woman's husband, and then he loses a child, and the king that comes after David is Solomon. And Solomon starts off great too. He asks for wisdom, and then he builds the temple in Jerusalem. But then he takes 700 wives and 300 concubines, which is absurd. And then he starts worshiping all of his wives and concubines' idols and other gods. And he puts other gods before God, before Yahweh. And Solomon goes crashing into the ground. And so you just see, and that's probably where most of us stop, right? If you're like, whoa, this is a lot of information. I know, it's a ton of information, but it's so good to get the big picture. And I know you've heard these names, but again, we're trying to connect the big picture story. And so then we're going to slow down a little bit. We get to this guy named Rehoboam. Rehoboam is the son of Solomon. And that's probably a name that maybe you haven't heard before. Maybe it sounds familiar, but he's important because he tries to enact this gigantic tax on God's people, on Israel. And they're like, we are not having any of that. And so the northern kingdom is created and the southern kingdom is created. God's people divide into two. In the north, they're led by a guy named Jeroboam. This is so confusing. Jeroboam is the king of the north and Rehoboam is the king of the south, right? That sounds ridiculous, but it's true. And the north is in Samaria and the northern kingdom is called, does anybody know? Israel. And the southern kingdom is in Jerusalem and the southern kingdom is called Judah. Oh my gosh, you guys know this. So this, again, this is a lot of information, but really helpful context when you're reading. And there's Israel mentioned and Judah mentioned, and you're going, what's going on? There's two separate kingdoms now. And so 1 and 2 Samuel, 1 and 2 Kings, 1 and 2 Chronicles trace the ups and downs of all these kings, 20 kings in the north and 20 kings in the south. So if you open your Bible to 1 or 2 Kings or Chronicles and you're reading and you hear about the nation of Judah or the kingdom of Israel, that's what you're reading about. The kings in the north and the kings in the south. And there's 20 kings in each. And these kings are rated in the Bible either as good kings or bad kings. And I know this is a lot of history, but where does this criteria come from? Deuteronomy chapter 17 says these kings are rated on three criteria. Do they wholeheartedly love God? Do they rid the people of idol worship or do they promote it? And do they fulfill the covenant that God set before them? Are they faithful to the covenant that God made with them through Abraham? And if they do, they're a good king. And if they don't, they're a bad king. Does that make sense? And so there's 20 kings in the north. Guess how many of them are good? Zero of the kings in the north are good. What did I call them at the beach? Scumbags. Everyone laughed at that for some reason. They were all scumbags. That's what my mom always says. In the south, there were 8 good kings and 12 scumbags. And the south was Judah. This is the kingdom in Jerusalem. And you see little pockets of faithfulness, of moments where God uses prophets and seers to help guide the kings and get them back on track, but they just keep disobeying. And so I want to give you an example. Here's one little moment. If you're wondering what a prophet is and how those fit together, well, the prophets are inserted in these key moments where God is trying to get his people back. And the prophets are spokesmen for God and they say, turn from your evil, turn back. go back to the loving God who cares for you, who wants to bless you and fulfill his covenant for you. Don't forget who he is. Don't forget what he's done for you. So there's this moment in 2 Chronicles 18. I want to read you the story of a good king. Have you ever heard of Jehoshaphat? Kinda, right? Like, kind of sounds familiar. Here's what happens to him. He makes an alliance with the northern kingdom. He's the king in the south. He makes an alliance with the northern kingdom, and he's trying to decide whether to fight with them. And he's looking for the wisdom of God. And he says this in 2 Chronicles 18, 6. Is there no longer a prophet of the Lord here whom we can inquire of? In other words, I want the wisdom of the Lord. Help show me what to do. And the king of Israel answered Jehoshaphat. You guys, this verse is ridiculous. If you zoned out, listen to this. There is still one prophet through whom we can inquire of the Lord, but I hate him because he never prophesies anything good about me, but always bad. He is Micaiah, son of Imlah. That's what the northern king says. I hate him because he never prophesies anything good about me. Okay, so this is the prophet that Jehoshaphat is seeking out. So the king of Israel called his official, says, bring him. And the messenger goes to summon him, the prophet, and says in verse 12, look, the other prophets, without exception, are predicting success for the king. Let your word agree with theirs and speak favorably. In other words, the messenger goes and says, listen, everybody else has said something good. Here's what I need you to say if you want to keep your job. And Micaiah, the prophet, says in verse 13, as surely as the Lord lives, I can tell him only what my God says. That's important. Prophets are spokesmen for the Lord. They say or demonstrate or act out only what God has allowed them to, only what God has said. And Jehoshaphat goes on to listen, to obey the word of the prophet, and he's successful. On the other hand, in 2 Chronicles 24, here's another example of a prophet. The Spirit of God came upon Zechariah, son of Jehoiada, the priest. He stood before the people and said, this is what God says. Why do you disobey the Lord's commands? You will not prosper. Because you've forsaken the Lord, he has forsaken you. It sounds like an obvious message, right? You've disobeyed. Hey, reminder, guys, you're disobeying the Lord. You're disobeying his covenant. What do they do in response? Verse 21, they plot against him, and by order of the king, they stone him to death in the courtyard of the Lord's temple. So the prophets have a really hard job. Most of them are unsuccessful at reminding the kings and the people about God's love and repentance and what they're supposed to do to fulfill their end of the covenant. But God, regardless, proves over and over and over again, I'm gonna protect my people. I won't forget my people. I will watch over the line of David. I will fulfill my covenant to Abraham now and for the next generation and the next generation, the next generation through Jesus and into eternity. So I wanna lead you into where all this goes. Where do we end? Settle in as I read to you. This is like kind of the summary. If you're like, okay, this is too much history. I can't follow where you're going. Are you guys kind of following? This is a lot. I'm sorry. I know this feels like a lecture. I warned you. This is different. But here's a good summary of what happens, okay? Just really think through this with me. So in the 12th year of Ahaz, king of Judah, Judah's in the south, Hoshea became king of Israel in Samaria in the north, and he reigned 9 years. He did evil in the eyes of the Lord. So in the 9th year of Hoshea, the king of Assyria captured Samaria. What's Samaria? That's Israel. That's where their territory is, right? Samaria and Jerusalem. And deported the Israelites to Assyria. He settled them in Halah, in the Gozan on the Habor River, and in the towns of the Medes. All of this took place, verse 7, because the Israelites sinned against the Lord their God. Pay attention to this part. Who had brought them up out of Egypt from under the power of Pharaoh, the king of Egypt. They worshipped other gods. They followed the practices of other nations the Lord had driven out before them and the practices that the kings of Israel had introduced. The Israelites secretly did things against the Lord their God that were not right. From watchtower to fortified cities, they built high places all in their towns. They set up sacred stones and Asherah poles, which is Canaanite worship, on every high hill and every spreading tree. They burned incense, as the nations whom the Lord had driven out before them had done. They did wicked things. They aroused the Lord's anger. They worshiped idols, though the Lord had said, "You shall not do this." The Lord warned Israel through all his prophets and seers. If you're, again, wondering, who are the prophets? They're the warning guys. They came in to try to help redeem the people. Turn from your evil ways. Observe my commands and decrees in accordance with the entire law I commanded your ancestors to obey and that I delivered to you through my servants and the prophets. But they would not listen. They rejected his decrees, verse 15, and the covenant he made. They imitated the other nations around them, even though the Lord had ordered, do not do as they do. Why did God give the laws? To set his people apart, right? To make them holy. Yet, they kept doing as the other nations did. They bowed down to the starry host. They worshiped Baal. They sacrificed their sons and daughters in fire. I mean, these people were far gone. These are God's people. They practiced divination. They sought omens. They sold themselves to do evil in the eyes of the Lord, arousing his anger. Verse 18, so the Lord was angry with Israel, and he removed them from his presence. Only the tribe of Judah was left, and even Judah did not keep the commands of the Lord. Therefore, the Lord rejected all the people of Israel. He afflicted them and gave them into the hands of plunderers until he thrust them from his presence. And this is the story of the kings and the prophets, and it kind of sucks, doesn't it? You're listening to this going, this is depressing. There is this faithful God who has said over and over and over again, I want to bless you. I will bless you. I will bless your descendants. I will be faithful to you no matter what. Here's what I want from you in return. Put me first. Get rid of the idols. Seek me alone. Keep my covenant. And they're like, no, actually, Lord, we're not going to do that. And so they run themselves into the ground. And it's this picture that we have of a faithless group of God's people. It reminds me of this story that I think I told years ago about my son, August, my oldest son, who... if you've been at the river for a long time, you've probably heard me share this story, but when he was little and learning to eat, he had these little pouches that I would give him. And there was this one moment where he's like testing me, and he squeezed his pouch all over the couch, and I was like so mad. Like, no pouch on the couch, honey. And then I give him another pouch, and he looks at me this time, and I'm like, he's not gonna do it again. And he does it again. I'm like, no pouch on the couch, August. And then I'm like, but he's a good kid. He's going to get it this last time. So I give him a third pouch. It was my first kid. I've learned a lot since then. And he squeezes it all over the couch again. And I'm like, what in the world? Like, how could he disobey me? You know, again, I've learned a lot. But that's like what God's people, it's like they're looking at God right in the eyes, just like August looked at me when he's squeezing this pouch all over. He's like, he knows exactly what he's doing. I've told him. Don't do it. And he just keeps doing it. It's almost like the little smirk is on his face, like while he's disobeying, like, nee, 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 nee. And that's like, this is God's people. They're just like, whatever, God. And yet, God is faithful, God is faithful, God is faithful. And there's no kingdom to show for it, but God is still faithful. And how do we know? Because we skip to the very end, to 2 Kings chapter 25, and I want to read this little ending to the story, and you're kind of going to go, what? What, God? How could you do that after all of this? So let's read 2 Kings verse 8. Well, this will be our last passage. I know you guys have been hanging with me for a while. On the seventh day of the fifth month in the 19th year of Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, Nebuzedaran, okay, commander of the imperial guard, an official of the king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem. he set fire to the temple of the Lord, the royal palace, and all the houses in Jerusalem. Every important building he burned down. So picture, I'm going to skip over all this next part, but it's really graphic about how basically he destroys Jerusalem. So we already read the passage about how the northern kingdom is destroyed, right, by Assyria. And now this is the southern kingdom getting destroyed. Burning, fire, captures, exile, murders, and then all of a sudden we skip to this. At the very end of 2 Kings chapter 27, this little postscript that's added in, and it makes you go like, huh? Here's what it says. In the 37th year of the exile of Jehoiakim, king of Judah. So Judah doesn't have a kingdom anymore, right? You're picking up on this. Jehoiakim is like a puppet king. He's still the king, but he's in prison. He's in exile by these Babylonians. Marduk became king of Babylon, and he released Jehoiakim, king of Judah, from prison. Verse 28, he spoke kindly to him and gave him a seat of honor higher than those of other kings who were with him in Babylon. So Jehoiakim put aside his prison clothes, and for the rest of his life, he ate regularly at the king's table. Day by day, the king gave Jehoiakim a regular allowance as long as he lived. And I get to this part of the story, and it kind of makes me emotional. And I know most of you are like, oh, the history doesn't really get me. But think about this. Israel has turned their back on God over and over and over again. And yet, just like I still love my son after he squeezes the pouch even 3 times in a row, I would have loved him if he did it 10. God still loves his people. And somehow, even though they have blown it over and over and over again, he is faithful. And there's a glimmer of hope at the end of all this. He raises up a king who has no kingdom to sit at the king's table and eat the king's food. And you're looking at this going, how? And it makes you go, wow, God is on the throne. He is merciful. He is compassionate. It's evidence that he's faithful to his covenant with his people, that he's going to do and is doing what he said he was going to do from the very beginning, regardless of what Israel did for him. No king was successful, and they look around, and it doesn't look like the kingdom that they planned. And yet, God is carrying the line. You still see the glimmer of hope. You still see the one king left. From this generation to the next generation to the next generation until we get to the king, the only true good king, Jesus, right? And from Jesus into eternity. God is establishing a kingdom upon his faithfulness. That's it. It's not about any earthly thing. It's not about what the kingdom looks like here. It's not about what the people imagine the kingdom would look like. God is saying, this is my kingdom. I am God. I am on the throne. I have always reigned, and I will continue to reign. And this is important because fast forward to the New Testament, everyone's looking around going, when is Jerusalem going to be rebuilt? When are we going to get the kingdom back? And Jesus is like, the kingdom is already here. You missed it. You remember in Luke chapter 17 when he says the kingdom of God is in your midst right now. Here I am. Look at me. God has always been on the throne. He brought me to redeem and reconcile. That's where the big story of the Bible ends. To redeem and reconcile you, to continue God's kingdom with you a part of it. Reunited with God into eternity. And that's the big picture story. And when I look at this text, when I read through all this story and I see, what are you doing, God? Who are you? What are you revealing to me about yourself? That's the way we're supposed to read Old Testament narrative, is what does this reveal to me about God? God's the main character of the story. Yesterday, I sat with the Lord and I just made a list based on what I've read in 1 Samuel and 2 Samuel and 1 Kings and 2 Kings and 1 Chronicles and 2 Chronicles. What does this reveal to me about who you are, God? I see that you are mighty. I think that was the first thing I wrote. I see that you are compassionate. I see that you are forgiving. I see that you are all-powerful. I see that you're good. I see that you're a father. And I started to make this list. And then I take this list about who God is, and I say, if this is who you are, God, then I can trust and believe in your faithfulness in my life, in all of these other places. I'm in a really personal, heavy season in my life right now. And I've gone through a lot in my past, too. And I can look back and I can say, okay, Lord, even when I almost lost my little brother 15 years ago, you were faithful. Even when I almost lost my oldest son 6 years ago, you were faithful. Even when I almost lost my dad 3 years ago, you were faithful. Even though I just lost my uncle last week, you are faithful. You are still on the throne. You are still compassionate. You are still mighty. You are still Father. And you will be, and it doesn't make sense. And I am zoomed in right now, and I'm looking at brokenness, and I'm looking at sadness, and I'm experiencing pain, but I am trusting in who I see that God is and who he has been for me in my life. All of the places in the past and all of the places in the future, he's the same God, and I can bank on that. And that's what we see when we look at this text, is a king on the throne. And regardless of what's happening in your life or in our world or in our country, God is on the throne. He always has and he always will be. He is the one who holds the cards. He is all powerful. He is good. He loves us. And as we look at him and are reminded of the fact that we are a part of his kingdom, it changes our perspective. It changes the way we live. It changes the way we interact with people. It changes the way we love. So we're going to close this morning, and we're going to sing worship to our King. We're going to sing all hail King Jesus. Will you close in a prayer with me? Lord God, you are King. You are King. You are King. We are not worthy. We do not deserve to sit at your table. And yet, just like Jehoiakim, you have raised us up to eat the king's food. Even now, I'm thinking about communion, what we're walking into. Eating bread and drinking juice. The representation of the sacrifice that you made for us with your body and your blood. Jesus, because you love us and you desire for us to be reconciled to you, to be a part of your kingdom, to play a part of your kingdom that is here and now. And it's coming. It will be fulfilled, but it's also here. It's present. It's a reality. Lord, we are your servants. We trust you. Even when things do not make sense and we look around and we feel discouraged or broken or hopeless, Lord, I pray that this story of the king's period would remind us of your sovereignty in and through all, of your power, of your goodness, of your faithfulness. No word of yours has fallen short. It never has, and it never will. You are the rock upon which we stand. You are our firm foundation. That's all we have to give you, Lord, is our worship. All hail King Jesus.
elements are being passed out right now. Can I invite you to stand? When you get the elements, go ahead and take them whenever you feel ready.
They made for sinners. For every curse, his blood atoned. One final breath, and it was finished. But not the end we could have known.
For the earth began.
For the earth began to shake. The veil was torn. What sacrifice was made as the heavens rose.
Dark cold tomb. Jesus, would you lift our weary heads to your holiness, to your sovereignty, to your mercy? As you are just, you are full of mercy, rich in love, slow to anger. So, Lord, when we have lost hope, when we are searching, would you lift our heads to your glory, to the undeniable truth of your provision and your love and your passion for us? May that be the truth that we set our hearts on this morning. We exalt you. We put you above all other names. Thank you for the price that you paid, that we would know you, that we had access to you, Jesus. So we lift you up. We exalt you. We worship you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, we're just going to play for a little bit. If you guys need to linger or head out, go ahead. But it's good to be back with you all. We'll see you next week. Thank you.